Victorian Premier Daniel Andrews facing calls from businesses to step down over his long roadmap out of lockdown.
He is an utter incompetent. He has stuffed the quarantine, he's stuffing the contact tracing, he's stuffing the testing. The only thing he's good at is trashing the Victorian economy.
Didn't miss, did he? And Christine Ahern leads our coverage from Victoria's State Parliament. Chris, this comes off the back of criticism from the Prime Minister.
Ali, the Prime Minister launched a scathing critique of Daniel Andrews' roadmap out of restrictions, saying it is crushing news for all Victorians and hopes that it is a worst-case scenario and can be fixed with better contact tracing, saying Victoria can learn from New South Wales, describing New South Wales's contact tracing as the gold standard. To be fair, here in Victoria, the contact tracing has significantly improved, and in defence, the Premier says the team is now hitting all its targets. But there is no doubt that the Premier is under enormous pressure. And now news this morning that the federal government says they have not received all the data that the Victorian government has based this long and arduous roadmap on.
Wuhan was under lockdown for 2.5 months. Believe it or not, Melbourne will be under lockdown for 3.5 months. And I think that will astonish people when they see that comparison.
It has also been revealed this morning that the Andrews government has enlisted US software giant Salesforce to help out with contact tracing. It does seem a little late in the piece. What this will do, what this program will do, will send automated text messages to health officials, infected people, and possibly their close contacts to tell them of a positive case. Other states already have this technology, New Zealand as well, and the Age is reporting this morning that Victoria was actually offered this by Salesforce back at the start of the pandemic, but rejected it. Ali?
OK, thanks, Chris.
A Melbourne family caught sneaking into Queensland on a super yacht are believed to have been released from hotel quarantine. Mackenzie Coulihan is on the Gold Coast with the details. Mackenzie, where are they now?
Carl, they're back on holiday. Melbourne construction magnate Mark Simmons and his family spent the past fortnight holed up here inside this hotel behind me on the Gold Coast, but their 2 weeks hotel quarantine finished at midnight last night, and while we are still awaiting confirmation, it's understood they were not wasting any time and they left about 1 minute after that. Now, they of course were forced into quarantine after their mega yacht, the Lady Pamela, was intercepted here on the Gold Coast after coming into Queensland from Melbourne, but the family disembarked another number of times on their journey up the East Coast, which was a big no-no and definitely not part of the strict conditions of their exemption. Now, as a result, they were fined for breaching Queensland's border restrictions, and the skipper of the boat has actually since been fined. But despite that, they all are all now free to go, and it's understood they are allowed to continue their holiday and stay in Queensland.
Mackenzie, thank you.
Reinforcement staff have been sent into Ipswich Hospital in southeast Queensland after another nurse tested positive, taking the total number of cases connected to the cluster to 5. More than 200 staff remain in quarantine with elective surgeries now cancelled. Sydney is also fighting hospital outbreaks, with more than 100 health workers this morning waiting on COVID test results after 4 new cases were confirmed in Liverpool and Concord hospitals. A doctor worked at both facilities while infectious. Well, studying for the HSC during a pandemic hasn't proven easy for school leavers, but the good news is that the ban on school formals in New South Wales has been lifted. Gabrielle Boyle is at Sydney's Luna Park this morning. Gabby, not all milestones have been spoiled this year.
Oh, what a rough year it has been for our Year 12 students, Charles. They've performed under such difficult circumstances and they've been ripped off of so many milestones in their final year of school. But COVID is not going to steal their Year 12 formal, with confirmation that Year 12 formals and graduation ceremonies will go ahead. There are a few restrictions and criteria that will need to be followed through with. One of those, they will not be able to be held before November 12th. That is the date of the last HSC exam. And students will still be expected to keep that 4 square metre rule in those facilities, but they will be allowed to dance and they will be able to mingle with their friends. For the group of teenagers who campaigned long and hard to have formals permitted, this is fantastic news.
It honestly means the world to have this milestone ahead, something to look forward to after such a horrible year for everybody, really, but in particular for Year 12.
It's also really good news, Charles, for all of those industries that are dependent on Year 12 formals. Think hairdressers and makeup artists, dress designers, suit hire companies, hire cars, the list goes on. So many industries are backed up by this period at the end of the year, school formal and end of year celebration season. So it's a really important green light for those industries, as well as our much deserving Year 12 students.
Some dress shops about to have a busy Tuesday morning, Gabby. Thank you. We have some breaking news for you now. A woman has been found after a night missing in bushland in Sydney's north. 70-year-old Stella Lowe was separated from her friends at the Ku'ring'ai National Park around midday yesterday, and after a major search operation was spotted walking along the M1 at Barara this morning. She's now being checked over in Hornsby Hospital. Thousands of Australians who deferred their loans in the wake of the pandemic could soon get a call from their bank as the six-month repayment reprieve comes to an end. But ANZ CEO Shane Elliott says there are other options for those still struggling.
Interest rates are really, really low. What does that mean? It means that time is actually quite cheap. So we've got the ability to buy time for people to get back on their feet, get back into employment, get their businesses started again.
Data shows that 900,000 Australians have deferred their loans since March, and 450,000 of those are likely to be reassessed. An inquest into the murder of two children in Sydney's northwest has heard holes in the system allowed an abusive father to obtain firearms. 67-year-old John Edwards gained access to five guns despite an extensive history of domestic violence. He shot his son and daughter at their West Pennant Hills home in 2018. Before taking his own life. And if you or anyone you know is a victim of domestic violence, there is help out there. Call 1-800-RESPECT. That's 1-800-737. Cricketing great Shane Warne and the boss of the MCC are the latest people to join a push to keep the MCG as the host of the Boxing Day Test. Isabella Staszkowski has the story for us. Isa, what exactly have they said this morning?
Charles, MCC CEO Stuart Fox says he's optimistic up to 30,000 spectators could come here to the MCG in December. This plan still needs to be approved by the state government, but big names are weighing in. Shane Warne this morning saying how important it would be to keep the event in Victoria. Now, this really does underpin on the success of the upcoming racing season. Racing Victoria does want to have crowds at events in October and November, and so if they are manageable, it really could pave the way for that Christmas miracle. Now, we do understand, though, if crowds aren't allowed here at the G by that point, that the test will be going to Adelaide. Now, even if you aren't a sports fan, this would have a massive boost, not only for our economy, but morale as well. And it would mean good news for a number of other restrictions. Charles?
Something to look forward to, Isa. Thank you.